Okay. Thank you, Giovanni, and thank you everyone for coming and seeing this talk. This is going to be again about benchmarking. I'm saying again because for the ones following the conference live, we just had one. More about statistics than benchmarking than Michael's one, but statistics is very important for benchmarking. This is actually going to be about benchmarking, like running benchmarks, and specifically running benchmarks with this tool, benchmarking suite, as a matter of fact, called MMTests. So just very quickly, I am Dario. I work for SUSE virtualization team since a few years. I've been in virtualization even before joining SUSE since a few more years. And yeah, apart from that, I also enjoy trying to contribute a little bit to OpenSUSE, both also in the virtualization space, but also outside of it, like in the Micros desktop, which is also better. So what we are going to talk about, we are going to talk about MM tests, and specifically about MM tests, how to use MM tests, let's say for virtualization, meaning for running benchmarks, of course, because this is what it does, but virtualization scenarios and contexts, so like running them inside virtual machines and this kind of stuff. And there has been other, is some materials, material, and there has been other talks about MM tests, both by me and also by others, people working on it. And so that's why the reason, why this talk is also called some updates, because I'm planning to cover, to try to focus on things that are changed, for example, since the last time that I myself talked about it at these two other conferences. And just very quickly, quick introduction about what MM tests is. It's a benchmarking suite, basically. It's born as a memory management benchmarking suite, so a tool for running benchmarks that would highlight performance improvements or regressions in the memory management subsystem. But then it evolved from that to into being much more than just that. It's originally developed, and I think we can say still maintained, by Mel Gorma from the performance team and upstream kernel maintainer. Yeah, the development is visible and on GitHub, and you can also participate in the development on GitHub, especially if you are outside of SUSE. It's, as I know, and or by email. It's a collection of scripts in Bash and Perl as main languages. I must remember not to mention about trying alternative solutions like rewriting it in, for example, something like Go. I remember that I mentioned that during one of those other conferences, and I did it because we had Matt Fleming in the company, which was for personal reason, as far as I know, studying Go. And so I mentioned it kind of as a tongue in cheek for him, and a few later he left the company and went somewhere else. So I don't want to cause anything like that again, in case it was my fault. So I'm not saying that it should be rewritten in any other language. Basically, what a benchmarking suite does, and MMTest is no exception, is providing a way and also an environment, I shall say, for running benchmarks in repeatable, reproducible, and controlled environment. In fact, MemTest itself fetches the benchmarks, for example, from a known location, either on the web or in a mirror. It then manages the configuration of the benchmark themselves and also of the platform. It then store the results in a way that are easy to then retrieve and consult. It performs some statistics that allows you to look at some statistical analysis of the data collected. It can draw plots and it can also monitor. That's how we call it. The system while running the benchmark, which means basically sampling things like top, MPStat, VMStat, IOStat, and all this. And also collect data from PAIR for F-trace, for tracing, to monitoring, to have a feel of what's going on in the system while the benchmarks are running. So yeah, that's it. There are a number of benchmarks already supported out of the box when you just start using MemTests. This is a super incomplete list, especially considering that new ones are being added actively. It's quite a few of them being added the time. And it's also possible to run them in interesting ways, like run multiple benchmark one after the other, but also multiple different benchmark at the same time. See, for example, what happens if you run Kernbench and at the same time you run another CPU intensive or IO intensive benchmark or things like that to build interesting scenarios and load conditions, or try to replicate some workload, stuff like that. So as I said, it can show you the results and some statistics of the results. I'm sorry for the quality of the image, but the point of this is not looking at the actual numbers. It's just to show that you can let one view the results with quite a few statistical details. These are not the only one. Here we can see the mean, the average, the standard deviation, minimum, mother, and the max. There are others, and it also performs some significance tests. It's very thorough from this point of view. Sorry. It monitors the system, as I said. So, for example, these are graphs showing how busy the CPUs were while the benchmark was running. This one is a very nice one, in my opinion. It's an heat map which shows you exactly that, how busy the various CPUs were by taking advantage of different colors. So different colors are representative of different level of load on the various CPUs, and many others, graphs and plots. These are just a couple of examples. But yes, I said at the beginning that I wanted to give an update on what's new on MemTests, especially concerning using it for benchmarking virtualization. And so the first update that I'm going to give is going to be about documentation. So as I said, I gave previous talk about MemTest itself. At FOSDEM 2020, I said this about documentation. Two slides. Then at a later conference, I showed these two other slides. So, didn't change much. What about now? Well, now we do have some documentation. So, this is an update. And with that, yeah, let's conclude my talk. Any questions? Unless anyone think that having wrote documentation is not a major achievement that deserves itself being celebrated with a talk or something like that. Well, actually, I do have some more material in case you you think about that, but I'm quite happy about being able to write some documentation, although it's not complete, of course. Documentation is never complete, and there is a lot more to document and MM tests. So is benchmarking easy? That's actually the title of previous talk here at SUSE Labs conference. And I'm going to say that it's not, although I also want to say that I totally agree with Michael that making sure that we measure the proper data, that we run the benchmarks in the proper way, and then that we are able to try to analyze the result is way harder than running the benchmark themselves. But even running the benchmark themselves can be challenging, especially on virtualization, or at least that's my very much biased point of view. So, well, basically benchmarking means trying to measure the impact of something, or at least let's define it like that for the purpose of this talk. So I made some code changes, a patch to, let's say, the kernel. I am on bare metal, and I want to measure the impact of this change. So what I can do is to run some benchmarks like these ones, the different ones, depends on the change, of course, to measure the impact of various subsystems, maybe, with and without my change. And there is more to it, but let me simplify things like this for the bare metal scenario. Now, virtualization. Virtualization, assuming that you have the same kernel, the Linux kernel, both in bare metal and inside the VM, then it's basically the same in principle, but the cases are quite a few. There are quite a few more of them. Because in fact you can have your change neither in the host nor in the guest, or only in one of them, or in both of them. And in theory, again, of course, depends on the change, but in theory you may have to assess all the situations, all the combinations. So yeah, these ones. And again, you may want to run multiple benchmarks or multiple kind of benchmarks. And if you do, then you do have to do it in all the previous configurations. So it starts to become an exploding matrix of different runs and different benchmarks that you would have to do. Also, here we are considering configurations where we have bare metal and one virtual machine. How about, there can be more than one virtual machine. You can have two in this example, even more than that. And of course you do have again the situation where you have multiple virtual machines, all of them can have the change or only some of them, and you may even want to run not only multiple benchmarks, different benchmarks to assess the impact on different subsystems, but also are we sure that we are fine, for example, if you have multiple virtual machines running the same benchmark in all virtual machines, and that we don't want to try and run a different benchmark in different virtual machines and see if this makes a difference. So it's quite complicated, allowing me to call it like that. And there is one more thing. If you have multiple virtual machines, how do you run benchmarks inside of them? One option is to just start the benchmarks inside of the virtual machine and let them run. But I don't think it's a good idea personally, because you may end up in a situation like this. So where, for example, if each benchmark if the benchmark does multiple iterations for achieving statistical significance, then if you just let them run, sorry, you may end up in a situation like this where you have different iterations of the benchmark in different virtual machines not synchronized among each other, and so you are not really measuring the impact of your change in iteration number two in VM1, which is competing, let's say, with iteration number one in VM2, which doesn't make much sense. So you have to do something to try to put yourself in this situation where things are synchronized, iteration after iterations, or benchmark after benchmark, depends what you want to do. And so in MM tests, we do have it. There's a protocol which implements this state machine, which is beautifully depicted in this ASCII art, which is inside the code. Shameless plug because I did it. So sorry about that. Which I don't want to go into too many details about it, but it's basically a barriering thing. So the host is in control of the various steps required to run the benchmarks inside of the VMs. And it makes sure that all the VMs proceed in lockstep for each phase of the benchmarking, the entire experiments, let's say. And yeah, this is a very simple, but I think effective representation of that, where we see two VMs running benchmarks with MM tests, and we see that these were CPU intensive benchmarks, and we see that both show the same load. So basically, here is, for example, probably when a new iteration or a new benchmark started, and it's happening in sync in both VMs. And this is the same with quite a few more them. Config files. Config files are very important in MM test because it's via config files that you define the scenario. I like to call it like that. So you decide what you want to run and the configuration of your benchmark, but not only of your benchmark, also of the system that the benchmark is running on. So you put together this config file. I'm not going to go into the details of the syntax of the config files. There is no time. There are other places where this has happened, and there is the documentation where this is probably not very well documented yet. So room for improvement. We'll get there at some point. Just pointing out a few details that you can, with stuff like this, try to gain some knowledge about the hardware characteristic of the platform you're running on, like the topology. So, for example, the number of NUMA nodes and things like that. And the benchmark can then take advantage of such a knowledge and configure itself for run, for example, a number of thread equal to the twice as much as the number of NUMA nodes and things like that. In the case of benchmarking virtualization workloads, this one that I'm showing here is a typical benchmark config file, which means that it's the config file that is considered for configuring the benchmark and the system hosting the benchmark, which is, if you are in virtualization, the virtual machine or the virtual machines, the guests. So inside the virtual machine, we configure the benchmark and we run it. We do have, since not too recently, but it's not super new addition, host config files as well for the virtualization use cases, where you can define some parameters and configure the platform as far as the host is concerned as well. So, for example, we can decide to run tune the or pneumatic on the host, and also we can have monitoring at both the guest level, which was this one. So monitoring is what I said. So I said before, like sampling MPStat, VMStat, those kind of things. And if the monitoring that you configure here in the guest config file will monitor what's happening inside of the VM which is running the benchmark. So what the various tasks and threads of the benchmark are doing inside of the virtual machine. On the other end, the monitoring that you configure at the host level will show you insights about what's happening at the host level, which means what the vCPUs, for example, of the virtual machines are doing, or the memory of the virtual machine, how much is it is used, allocated, whatever. Like to some really new stuff, so new that they are still in patches. They're almost ready, but I really wanted to finish and submit this before, but at some point I had to choose, like yesterday late evening, whether I wanted to do the slides or to finish the patches, and I opted for the slides. And I will try to call managed mode for benchmarking virtualization workloads with MMTests, meaning that MMTest itself, if configured like this, like I'm just about to show you, will manage the life cycle of the virtual machines involved in the test itself. This was there already to some extent, but not completely. So for example, MMTest itself will start, stop, reboot the VMs as it sees fit for the benefits of the benchmark, but it, with patches, will also be able to automatically provision them, so install them if you don't have them already in the system, while so far it could only use VM which were already present in the system and that you then had to manually configure, which was tedious and error prone and much worse and much slower to do when you had to do a benchmarking campaign. So the goal is to achieve complete automation, and I guess it's a little bit too slow, sorry about that, but it's possible. So for example, to define the name, the VMs that you want to use for running the benchmark inside of them, then there is a way still, this is an piece of the host config file. You can define some defaults. So for example, by default, if not otherwise specified, the VMs will have four vCPUs, but then you can refine the configuration for each VM. So VM1, in this example, will have two vCPUs and VM2 will have six, okay? Which could be useful if you want to, I don't know, run a benchmark in an heterogeneous VM situation, or if you want to run multiple benchmark changing the configuration of the VM. Of course, you put together two different config files and then you run the benchmark twice and then you compare the results. This is an example shows only this capability of changing the configuration of the VM for CPUs and memory. Right now in these patches, there is not much more than this, but of course, the possibilities are endless and I plan to add much more. Managed mode containers. So this is also almost ready in this experimental Git branch, barring one last bug, which I really hope to nail down soon. But it will be possible when it will be done to run benchmarks, not only inside VMs, but also inside containers managed by, for example, Podman or Docker. It works in a very similar way. We will have to do something about the names because it's currently called MMTest VMs, and then you specify the list of the containers that you want to use. Let's see also about that. But then similarly, you have some defaults. So for example, from what registry and which image you want to use for pulling creating the containers, or it can use Docker files to put them together and then run benchmarks inside of them and this kind of stuff. Also in this case, I am calling this managed mode as well, because MMTest will have with dispatches the ability to, as it was for VM, previous slide, controlling the entire life cycle of the container. So creating or pulling or building them from Dockerfile or images, or whatever, exactly as it is going to be able to create and provision virtual machines. And also stopping and starting them when there is the need to do so for running the benchmarks inside of them. The communications happens currently through network, so it uses a shared network link, which is usually there both in case of VMs and in case of containers. There are other possibilities not yet implemented. I really plan to add different communication means, for example, for VM, virtual IOVSOC and this kind of things, but it's not there yet. Network is though and works for both the use cases, VMs and containers. And yeah, in this case, apart from specifying, it's not visible in this example, apart from specifying some details about the networking configuration, which is the IP address of the interface that the host, and in fact it goes in the host config file, that the host should use to communicate to either containers or VMs, then it then should MMTest itself figure out automatically, for example, things like the IP address of the VMs and other containers and stuff like that, and then also, as I said, manage their life cycle and start and stop them and everything. Although there is another possibility, which is instead of letting MMTest try to figure out the, for example, details like the IP address of the VMs or of the containers automatically, you can manually specify it, which seems not very useful. It's actually less convenient situation than before, and that's actually indeed the case, but it could be useful if, for example, you want to run your benchmark inside something that you don't even know if it's a VM or a container, or for example it's a VM but it's managed by KubeVirt, and the KubeVirt and managing the lifecycle of KubeVirt VMIs is not yet implemented in MMTest. I have plans for it, but it's not there. There are not even draft patches, nothing. But I mean, even KubeVirt VMs have an IP address and you want to try to run a benchmark inside of them. So you lose the, in this case, you don't have the nice feature of MMTest being able to control the life cycle of these things, but you can still run benchmarks inside them. So that's pretty useful. And for example, it's what we used for running some benchmarks in KubeVirt, the results of which you will see in another talk here at SuseLabConf. So that's another pretty new stuff. This one is, at least this one is already merged. So it's not, I'm not only talking about stuff which is not yet finished. And yeah, some more future plans. And this time, I mean, for this part, I'm not talking about future plans for MMTest features, like yeah, KubeVir support, more customization of VM configuration, which are indeed in my to-do list. But I'm talking about something else. I'm talking about what we would like to do with OMMTest for virtualization benchmarking in the virtualization team. As I said, it's already widely used, at least in the performance team, as you probably know already. But we would like to use it much more ourselves. So, for example, it could be useful to have it available handy for any developer to do some performance assessment of changes that they are making, the code that they are developing, see whether or not there is an impact on performance of what they are doing. And that could, of course, be done if you just download it and configure it manually on your system or on a test box, but it would be nice if it could be done by some as a service on some shared machine or something like that. We would also like to use it to track a little bit proactively, more proactively than what we are doing right now, the performance improvement and regression that would come from, for example, patches inside the upstream projects that we care about, which is kernel, but specifically the KVM related changes and KIMU and a few others. Kubert, for example, I didn't put in the slide, but it's very much there. Which would mean that we should somehow track their development and then let such development, like when patches appears or when commit appears, trigger some benchmarks. And also do the same, but for downstream packages, that we have in both SUSE and OpenSUSE. And yeah, again, here you track the development of the packages, so the builds in the build service, for example, and you trigger benchmarks when new ones are ready. So the problems that we are facing trying to put together, we are still at the, well, there are some proof of concept in place, but I am still thinking at what's the best solution. What the best solution could be for achieving something like this, and the some of the problems that we are facing is the fact that we need some, or at least it would be good to have some host management. So, for example, let's say that you want to run a benchmark, you have the configuration, you want to run this benchmark inside these three VMs configured in a certain specific way, and you want to run it on Lipos Li 15.2 and 15.3, and you want to check the differences. Of course, you need to have the correct version of the operating system, so 15.2. Installed, run the benchmark, then reinstall the host and run the benchmark again. So you need some host management in this sense, not only configuring like the CPU frec governor for the host, but actually reinstalling it. And I told you before that MMTest is going to be able to provision VMs, but it doesn't do anything, and I don't think it will be its job to do anything about host provisioning. Upstream tracking and also downstream tracking, so there must be to figure out a way of triggering benchmarks, as I said already, triggering benchmarks when something happened, either patches appear on mailing lists or commits appear in some branches or even just periodically from time to time, checking out, say, the KIMU sources from Git and run benchmarks on and build it and install it and then and run our benchmarks or something like that. And then there is the matter of putting the results somewhere where we can not only look at them immediately after the benchmark, but also build an history of what's going on and stuff like that. So this is something that, these are all things that, as I said, I don't think that MMTest itself should do. In fact, there are other projects and other tools and other software components that are doing that already. For example, yes, thanks Giovanni. For example, still in the performance team, they use a tool called Marvin quite a lot. There have been talks about it as well at previous editions of LabsConf, for example, which is a I'm not going into the details of Marvin here, but it's another collection of scripts which does well pretty much all the things that I said before, with perhaps some exceptions, mainly, for example, the fact that it's probably biased, or at least it used the most for tracking kernel changes in kernel branches more than Kimu branches. It's still Git, so it's probably easy enough. But for example, packages, I personally don't know how well it would handle. Of course, everything is possible. That's for sure. It's just a matter of deciding. That's what I'm after here. But deciding which is the best way forward, with which will lead us to the best results with the least amount of effort, especially of least amount of duplicated effort. That's why I'm looking at things that are there already. And also, and another solution is that we are investigating is to see what's possible to do with GitLab and the GitLab actions and the thing that you can specify runners and triggers and all these kind of things, which is a little bit more integrated with, for example, our downstream workflow, because someone from our team worked on that, so it would be easier from that point of view. But on the other end, on GitLab, there is no way, well, you have to implement it if you want to manage hosts in the way I was saying before, so reinstalling the operating system on one of the runner. It's not like there is a GitLab action that does it, at least as far as I know. Instead, for example, in things like Marvin, there is one because Mel basically implemented it already. With the help of Ortos, which is the system that manages some of our servers, I think, which is which could or could not be a problem, because it's, I'm not sure it's something that we could use in for the machines that we are interested in using this thing on. And then there are also other solutions on which I know about, which I know less than how much I know these two that I just mentioned. One which is interesting is this runperf thing, which was also presented at this edition of KVM Forum, which happened a few weeks ago, which looks interesting, but I, to be honest, still have to properly dig into it and see how it works and if it can be a solution for us. So, yeah, I mean, just with Marvin and GitLab in mind, if this is the slide where I list some of the issues that we are facing, and yeah, it seems to me that doing something like deploying Marvin in some VM in our environment would solve more of them. But I'm still looking, and if anyone which has interest and knowledge of these platforms, but also of this problem, and in general, I am very much welcome. I very much welcome any comments or advice, any kind, both here or offline. And now that's really pretty much it. I'm just adding a mandatory disclaimer, because I do really like MMTest a lot, and apart from the thing that I discussed in this last part of my presentation, which is using it as a CI, which is actually probably the where it gives it does its best. But I do think that it's a great tool also for day-to-day development. So basically assessing performance of the development that you are doing daily on whatever thing is it that you are doing such development. Also, it's idea is that you should be mindful of where you run it, and you better have a dedicated test box or at least a machine that it's not your pet workstation where you have your most precious things and configurations. It's not going to destroy anything itself, like data or pictures of your vacations or something like that, but it needs to be run as root because it may need to change something like the configuration of the host system for changing the governor or installing packages and stuff like that are necessary for the benchmark. And some of these things are rolled back at the end of the experiment, but not all of them. So, for example, we don't remove the packages that we installed. And it also downloads the benchmark from the internet while running as root. So the nightmare of every security person internally, when it works as a CI, we do it in a safer way, which is setting up a mirror, which is easy enough. But if you don't do it, then it will just download random stuff from the internet as root. And so you are very much welcome to use it, and I think you should, and I'm happy to take to try to help anyone trying to do it, but just know about these things. And this time is it but for real? I think we have some time for questions if there are any.
That is correct. We do have a few minutes for questions. I don't think there was any question in the chat.
I saw
If
something passing
no.
by, but it was already answered, probably.
Right. There was Vincent from Release Engineering asked a web page for slash benchmark results. Mel replied, so that is taken care of. And a question between about the relationship between MMTest and OpenQA. Do we use MMTest with OpenQA? I'm thinking about some benchmark on our GOS images for SLA and OpenSUSE, and reference to Martin Ryszka, maybe know something about the relationship between MMTest and OpenQA. I personally don't know, maybe.
I personally don't know either. I don't think, not sure we do much performance benchmarking in OpenQA. I know that, of course, we have QA or QE, as it's called now, department which does performance benchmarking. I don't think they use MMTest, but it's MMTest that implements some of the tests that are used by QA, so it's possible to try and reproduce the issue on either platform.
I have one comment in chat from Mel that says, don't know about OpenQA, but as there would be interference between multiple VMs running on the same host, reproducibility would be a factor.
Yeah, for performance benchmarking, you need a controlled environment are able to, you know, what's going on, how it's configured. That's what I was mentioning before with or implying at least with host management, because oftentimes you reprovision it from scratch before every benchmark, or at least before every campaign, because you really want to be sure that there is nothing left that could bias the results. There is a raised hand. Andreas?
Yeah, just for the record, OpenQA can also run tests on bare metal machines. It does not necessarily need to run them in virtualization.
Yeah. I mean, MMTest itself, it's running it. It's a matter of even have packages for not in factory, but in a developed project, which right now I out the name later. I don't remember right now, but it's easy enough to download it as a tarball or from Git and then put together the config file and run it. So possible to do it everywhere. I don't think it's happening right now.
Right, if there are no other questions, I will
Yeah.
thank Dario for the interesting presentation on updates on MMTest and virtualization testing.
Yes, and thank
Welcome.
you, Giovanni, for moderating, and thank you, everyone, for attending.